Lord, there is none like you. We worship you, we adore you, and we praise you. We take a position of yes, and we say yes to you. Let your holy scriptures flow through me tonight. Let it pierce the hearts of the people that are watching. Let every person be filled with your joy. Let every person receive the peace that you promised them. My peace I leave you, my peace I give you. May your name be glorified in all that we do. I praise you, Lord. I thank you. I give everything to you in Jesus' name. And the people watching said, amen. Hey, welcome everybody. Merry Christmas. Tuesday night service here. And we are going to minister out of the book of Psalms tonight. I'm pretty excited about this because I like Psalms. And this is really a good one. But before I do that, I want to give everybody from our church an opportunity and receive our tithes and offerings. If you give by way of check or cash, we can't do that tonight because we're online. But you can always give as we normally do, and you know how we do that. It should be on the screen somewhere around here. You know how to work it electronically. But we receive those tithes and those offerings, and we give, but we honor God by our givings. We honor him with our tithes. We honor him with our offerings. But if you are not if Revelation Church is not your home church, then we ask you to please make sure that your tithes go to your home church, because churches are building their community, and they count on your tithes to build that community. That's what it's for. We build the community. Offerings, you're welcome to give. And we praise God for all that do in Jesus' name. Amen? Amen. All right, let's get to Psalms tonight, if we could. Psalms 96 I sat there, and I was reading through it before I actually broke it down and studied it the best I could. I was reading through it, and I was seeing that how much passion was in this, was not only in David, but all the other psalmists that were involved, and the passion that were in these psalmists. It's like, my gosh, I was jealous, and I'm like, Lord, can we have that today? What can we do in our church? What can we do in our churches, or the church, to just have that same passion that they had back then? And I think, you know, I'm not sure if what it's going to entail or what it takes, but if we just learn these scriptures, and we say, they're just as alive today as they were when they were written. If we can hold on to these scriptures and just passionately desire them instead of passionately desiring what we want in life, my God, in all of heaven, what we could do as a kingdom-building group of people. So may I just read the psalm, and I'm just going to read it through, and then we'll go break it down here. So it says, like, goes like this. Psalm, starting with verse 1. Sing a new song to the Lord. Let the whole earth sing to the Lord. Sing to the Lord. Praise his name. Each day proclaim the good news that he saves. Publish his glorious deeds among the nations. Tell everyone about the amazing things that he does. Great is the Lord. He is most worthy of praise. He is to be feared above all gods. The gods of other nations are mere idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Honor and majesty surround him. Strength and beauty fill his sanctuary. And then I switched over right here to a different translation. Let the heavens be glad. Let the earth rejoice. Let the sea and everything in it shout his praise. Let the fields and their crops burst out with joy. Let the trees of the forest sing for joy before the Lord, for he is coming. He is coming to judge the earth. He will judge the whole world, or he will judge the world with justice and the nations with his truth. And so there's a lot of passion in this right here. And you say, what are we getting at tonight, Joe? Is this going to make me feel good? I don't know. I don't think every message is meant to make people feel good. I think every message is meant to get you closer to Jesus and get you closer to kingdom and kingdom building and kingdom mentality. And when we can remove us and let our focus be the kingdom of God and building his kingdom, then we reap the benefits of those blessings as well, mentally, physically, and spiritually. So if we want to break down verse 1, it won't take as long to go through all these verses, but starting with verse 1, it says, sing a new song to the Lord. Let the whole earth sing to the Lord. I thought about that, and I was reading it, I was studying it, and this is a command that was not just exclusive to Israel. What the psalmist was saying right here, he was saying, not only include Israel, but all the people of the earth, and not just the people, but everything in the earth. Every single thing in the earth, praise him. Everything that is created should praise the Lord. God created everything. absolutely everything. And everything has its way of praising God. And in Luke 19, verse 40, to kind of go along with this, Jesus says, he replied, if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out. And I thought about that, and I'm like, wow. What does that mean? If they keep quiet, the stones will cry. Because we quote that. If you're a believer and you're a Bible reader, you'll quote that all the time. You'll say, you know, if we don't praise God, the rocks will cry out. And rightfully so. But what was happening here is Jesus, when he rode in on the donkey, or he rode in on the colt, and it was called his triumphal entry. And as he was walking in, the Pharisees, his disciples were calling him Messiah. They were recognizing him as Messiah. Now, not the 12 apostles, but the many disciples that followed him. And they were recognizing him as a Messiah. And so the Pharisees were saying, quiet them and quit letting them call you Messiah. And Jesus was like, listen, I can't quiet them down. If I quiet them down, the rocks will cry out. The rocks will cry out. What is he trying to say? You cannot keep God's creation from crying out to him. Now, if we become a stubborn, stiff-necked generation as the Pharisees were in those days, then we are making a choice to not cry out to our Creator. But when you praise him, there is just healing in the body, in the mind, in the spirit when you praise that which created you. You don't always see it, and you definitely don't understand how it works, but there is something about just crying out. And the stubbornness says, listen, this is what we need to do. Don't focus on the people that are not crying out to God. Just make sure you're one that is. Because, I mean, I don't know how y'all feel, but to me, it'd be horrible to get to heaven and to say, I wouldn't praise God. I didn't recognize him. I didn't glorify his name. So God had trees and rocks cry out to him in the way that he hears them and understands them, not how we do. So I just think it's something important that we need to realize is, first of all, why do we praise God? But as the psalmist said here, I thought it was so beautiful, let the whole earth sing to the Lord. Not just the people of the earth and not just the Israelites, but all people, because he was literally pointing to the cross right here. All people, all generations, all of creation, all the heavenly stars, the luminaries, the stars, every being, angelic and human, everything will cry out to the Savior. Everything will bow at the feet of the Holy Spirit. Even Satan himself will acknowledge that God is God. Even Satan, his demons in hell, will acknowledge that he is the Savior. So it's just kind of like, what are we acknowledging? And sometimes we don't always cry out to God, and we don't always praise him from the innermost being of our passion. Why? Because we're so focused on us that we can't take a moment and acknowledge him. And if we acknowledge God, that means we put him before us in every way. If we're putting God before us, then we're actually going to put people before us as well. And we're going to love them with the love that comes from God. If God is first, then you receive that love. I can love you because he first loved me. He first committed to me. Now I can commit to you. I don't have to necessarily always like people. I don't always have to get along with people. But it's honorable to say, God committed to me, a sinner. Therefore, I should humble myself and humble myself to love that person, whether they're a sinner or not, whether you get along or not. That's how you praise God. You praise him by loving his creation. You praise him by adoring him for his creation. You praise God for creating. You just adore him, recognizing him as creator of all things. Not just human beings, luminaries, stars, galaxies, earth, everything in it. As I said the other day, the only thing that differs between the soil that you walk on and us made from the soil is that he breathed his life in us. And for that, let us be part of let the whole earth cry out. Let the whole earth sing to the Lord and praise him for his greatness. But then it goes on in verse 2 and 3. Excuse me. It says, sing to the Lord, praise his name each day. Proclaim the good news that he saves. And we're pointing to, we're literally pointing to Jesus here, because Jesus is the only one that saves. Through his salvation, through his death and resurrection, he brings salvation. But it says, each day proclaim the good news. Each day proclaim that God is God. Each day proclaim that he is King of all kings, Lord of all lords. But then it gets to verse 3, it says, publish his glorious deeds among the nations and tell everyone about the amazing things that he does. I don't know if that's in our life. Again, let's go back to the fact that how can we keep our eyes focused on God if they're focused so much on us? And the only reason they're focused on us is because maybe we don't trust him enough to take care of us. So we feel we have to take care of us. If the enemy can get us taking care of the little details that we can't have any control over in our lives and worrying about the details we have no control over and trying to forcefully, with pride or not, make things happen that we are not in control of, then the enemy has succeeded because he's got us so focused on us trying to change what we can't change that therefore we take our eyes off of he that is I am, he that changes, he that brings peace. So in all actuality, not only do we sing to the Lord, praise his name, but each day we proclaim the good news that he saves. We don't save. He saves. He saves others. He saves us from ourself. Publish his glorious deeds among the nations and tell everyone about the amazing things he does. So this psalmist is talking about Jesus. Jesus becomes man so that the word of God and the glorious power of God can be spread to the entire world. And what the psalmist says here in verse 2 and 3, Jesus actually said in Matthew 10, 27, where he says, what I tell you in the dark, speak in the daylight, and what is whispered in your ear, proclaim from the roofs. My God, I adore my creation, God says. I love you. I minister to you. I speak to you, but share it with the world. Don't let the remainder of this year, 2021, into the next year and the years to come, don't let these years be where it's all about you and me, meaning ourselves, about you, or for myself, about me. Make it to where it's like we yearn and we have such a great passion for God that we have to praise him. See, praise comes out of the human body going, I can't take it anymore. He's so good to me, I can't take it anymore. And I just get in a position and I praise him. And sometimes the only way you can ignite praise is to reflect on Scripture, on his goodness, on what he's done. And you can even reflect on your life and the greatness that he's done for you and in your life. But my God, in all of heaven, when we get to the place where it's not about us anymore, and we can just sit there and go, this is what God did, and I praise him, and I exalt his name, and I glorify his mighty name, and I got to share it with somebody. I have to proclaim his goodness. Whether we use our lips or not is another thing. But He has got to be so in you. The cross is in you. When the cross is in you, the cross will come from you. And everything that you do, every action, every bit of speech, everything that you do, your thoughts, how you treat people, how you are, your kind, just everything. Ah, what a world we live in if we just get to this. Verse 4, let me keep moving on. Verse 4 and 5, it says, great is the Lord. He is most worthy of praise. He is to be feared above all gods. The gods of other nations are mere idols, but the Lord made the heavens. So now let's talk about this for a second. This is powerful. Place Yahweh, God Almighty, above all false idols. Everything else is a false idol. Gods, small g, gods that made nothing should not be worshipped. Gods that have not died, rose again, should not be worshipped. They should not be adored. They should not endure your passion. They have done nothing. They have created nothing, and they have done nothing. Does that make sense? So you say, well, then where are the other gods besides ours that we should focus on? There isn't any. That's why he's king of all kings. He's Lord over all lords. There is none above him. There's none beneath him. There's none before. There's none after. There's none ever. It's him, God Almighty. I am that I am. Period. And so when he talks about this, there is no other God that you should give attention to but the one that actually did something. Because all other idols that they worshipped in those days, and even people that worship idols today, and you can take idols as in position, power, money, things, you know. But why would you want to adore, put energy, effort into or worship something that was created by someone just like you, a man. An idol was carved by a man. The poles that they did in the days of old, they were carved by men. Why would they be worshipped? The golden calf was created by man. But God, here's an oxymoron. In the days of old, and even in our present day, we worship things that were created by man, but yet we don't worship he that created man. Think about that. Because when you can understand that everything came from Yahweh, everything came from Yahweh, you can praise him in a position of understanding like never before. That's, to me, is just glorious. He will come as man to judge, and he will come as man to save. But reflect on everything that Yahweh has done for you, and looking ahead, knowing that what is coming for you has already been, because he's already been there. Oh, My mind right now is because I'm starting to reflect, and I'm about to shout for praise myself. Verse 5, can I just reflect on that real quick? The gods of other nations are mere idols. We just covered that. But the Lord made the heavens and the earth. So going back to the scripture, based on what I had said, why worship someone, something that was created by someone? Why wouldn't we not worship he that made the heavens and the earth and all of us that are trying to create idols from ourselves? Now, let the Lord minister to you there and see what you can come up with. Verse 6, let's move on. I could stay all day on that verse, and I probably should have moved on a few minutes ago. Honor and majesty surround him. Strength and beauty fill his sanctuary. Well, the heavens are filled with his glory. They're filled with his glory. Everything you look at is his glory, is his power. He created everything. I thought one time, I said, the stars and the galaxies and the universes, and maybe they're out there. I'm not into astronomy or science to that level, but maybe all that's together. Maybe it does keep everything flowing. I don't know. But for us down here on this planet, it's got many factors. And for us, the luminaries and the stars, honor and majesty surround him. The strength and beauty fill his sanctuary. Everything that you look at just blesses you. The trees, the mountains, the oceans, the stars, the moon, the sky at night. I mean, everything blesses you. And God took the time to create all that, maybe just to create a smile on your face, just to show you how much he loves you, because it was effortless for him. He just spoke it, let there be. Boom, there it was, all in place for you. Not for him, for you and me. I just love that. But it says that, so the heavens are filled with his glory. That position yourself to honor him and all his angelic beings along with the whole earth. Strength and beauty are in his sanctuary. Come on, church, let me just kind of reflect on this for a minute. Strength and beauty are in his sanctuary. This is his sanctuary right here. All that you ever need is in him, in you. But is he your adoration? Is he your priority? Is he your passion? Because when I read this and I read the Psalms, and I say, that's the passion I yearn for. I want to get there and beyond. I want to go further than them, because they just talked about Jesus. We have Jesus. Man, please forgive me if I'm rattling on, but boy, this blesses me so much. So the praise continues in the last three verses here, if I may. Just going to go through these real quickly. It says, let the heavens be glad and the earth rejoice. Let the sea and everything in it shout his praise. Let the fields and their crops burst out with joy. Let the trees of the forest sing for joy before the Lord, for he is coming. Jesus is coming, as they were saying this. Listen to what I'm telling you. He is coming, it says in verse 13. But for us, he has already come. Now he is coming again. Is that making sense? So he is coming. Look at this. This is back in the Psalms. Look at what they're preaching Revelation here. He is coming to judge the earth. He will judge the earth with justice and the nations with his truth. So with his truth, the word of God. Church, the only way that we can praise him and honor him and adore him is to know his truth And that is the Holy Scriptures of God. It's the Word of God. That's the only way that we, you and me, can praise Him. We cannot praise Him without the Scriptures. We can't praise Him. Oh, we can't honor Him without the Scriptures, because we know His goodness and His greatness through these Holy Scriptures. But I'm gonna leave you this in this week of Christmas, this week that we celebrate. We celebrate His birth, His death, and His resurrection every day. But in the day where the whole world is celebrating it in this week, can I ask you to give yourself the absolute greatest gift that anyone could ever give another person? Not just the gift of salvation, but for those that are already saved, give yourself the greatest gift, and that is ask God to help you desire Him with such passion that you can hardly breathe without thinking of Him. Let every scripture be filled with such joy and such passion. Let the Holy Spirit reveal so much to you, but it's got to start with a commitment by us. God has given us free will. Open your Bibles and read them. You don't have time because you don't understand. I've opened books in the past, books, novels, and I'm like, I don't even like this. I'm closing it. I'm not reading again. That book is someone's depiction of their story. But the Bible is Jesus Himself. And He is it's the heavenly kingdom. You're reading. You may not get it today, but it will open up. I told my wife that something I had talked to the Lord about probably 30-something years ago, I'm just getting revelation on. So you never know when that blessing is coming. It's like when you build your house in Florida. You build your house. We don't have most of our homes out here. They're hurricane-proof to the best we can, and that is we don't have wood first floors. We have block first floors. So the first floors of our homes and our apartments are block. They're solid block, and they're hurricanes for the hurricanes that come. I've been here in Florida many, many years, and we've never needed that block. But in the event that we do need that block house, that hurricane coming, in the event that we need it, what's inside that house is my precious cargo, my family. And at that moment, even if it never happens, but at that moment, when we need it, it's there. And you never know when that's coming. Same way with the scriptures. When you read these holy scriptures, you're going, I don't understand them. I'm just going to move on. I don't need this right now. But when you do, the Holy Spirit will reveal it. And that could save your life and your family's life. It'll definitely change from anxiety to peace and anxiety to joy. So listen, I'm here just telling you this on this beautiful season of Christmas that we're going to celebrate. Love Jesus. I just read you Psalms. This is before the birth. Love Him because they loved Him and they didn't even know Him yet. We know Him. He's come. We should love Him even more. So I pray over you, if you don't know this Jesus right now during this season, ask Him into your life. And how do you do that? By just, first of all, starting with repentance. God, forgive me. Moving on to a thought, knowing He was born, He was a recorded birth, He died, He had a recorded death, but He rose again, only one with a recorded resurrection. I don't understand that, Jesus, but I choose today to follow You. And as I continue to grow in the Word, You will explain to me and teach me that which I don't know. If you've never done that, if you've never said, I commit to Jesus today, let this be the first day of the rest of your life. Give yourself that greatest gift if you've never done that. And if you already are saved and you're already walking with God, then ask Him to give you a deeper passion, because that's what changes your life on this earth from peace and joy versus fear and anxiety. And so with that, Merry Christmas, everybody. Enjoy your families, because family's a great gift. If you're not getting along with somebody, go repent. Well, they're not going to receive. That's okay. At least you've asked. At least you put the first hand out there. And just love one another, because that's the greatest gift you can give each other. Amen. We're going to see you Sunday, the 26th. It's going to be amazing. Another day with the Lord as we celebrate Him. And to God be all the glory. Merry Christmas, everybody. We will see you very soon. Mm-hmm.